When we talk about that sustainable economics, and do you think that, and also you talked about that inclusiveness and responsibility, do you think that the responsibility in Indian economics to give a 2% profit as a CSR is the kind of, because it's the mandatory now, it's no more a voluntary, it's the kind of a methodology can be adopted in across the global perspective? Do you think this is something is very good?
It's a difficult thing for me to say, because I really do not know from the various countries developing to the third world countries what kind of government mandate is there in terms of contributing their profits to the societal improvement. So it's I don't think any such study or any such survey has been done, and usually I would tend to assume that it can't be that India is the leader and the other countries will be following. So India must have also followed the examples of a few other leading countries in this, because it's very difficult to assume that. But world sustainable economic development will not definitely come by a 2%, 3%, 4% distribution of the corporate profits, because the sustainable economic developments is a very, very difficult thing to achieve. It's a very difficult thing to achieve, because economics always go through certain cyclical phase.
Right.
It will go up, it will come down.
Right.
It will so therefore it always be a cyclical situation, and many factors, because again, as I mentioned, going back to that Pestel framework, economics is so strongly connected to the P dimension also as well as to the T dimension as well, because the technology changes the economics of the countries also, then the trade relations, the inter-country political situation, various things, individual characteristics also to a large extent of the leadership, that what kind of methods will they follow in bringing in economic prosperity. There are many, many deciding factors. So it's very difficult and then there are so many other things in terms of the consumption also, whether I'm going for a consuming expenditure, whether I'm going for a savings expenditure.
Right.
But when they actually mention that economic sustainable development, it means that a certain basic levels in most or in all the countries should have to be there, and those basic levels or the basic amenities should be there, is more keeping in mind the very strongly suffering African countries, the Latin American countries, many other remote countries suffering for political conflict, suffering from any climatic reasons,
yes.
Suffering for historical traditional reasons, suffering from any religious ethnicity kind of issues. So it could be, so when we say the sustainable economic development, it actually means that basic thing should be there. It also aims at another very difficult thing, which looks more difficult today, to bring in a little less disparity amongst the countries and within the countries also in terms of the income inequality.
Right.
Now, that also is very difficult to achieve, because with the advent of this digital coming in, the whole world itself is getting divided into two blocks called Digital North and Digital South.
Right.
Which is, if we take the countries below the equator, which is going more towards the African part and all that,
right,
they are considered as Digital South because they will be laggards in the digital adoption, whereas the North America, the European countries,
digital,
they will
north,
be more in the Digital North, far more advanced, and therefore the richness of these countries will be far more than the richness of these countries. So one inequality is coming from there itself. The other inequality is coming, on which there are a lot of research studies which is coming. The income inequality of the developed countries also has gone to the maximum level at this point in time than it has ever happened in history, because of this digital thing. All general average income of all people have gone up,
right,
but the inequality has gone up also.
Right.
So the inequality also has gone up. So therefore, that is another very difficult thing to really bring it down, But by economic sustainability, not that everything can be very quickly achieved, but the bare minimum economic comfort should be there, or a prosperity should be there across all the world for every citizen. That's basically the motto.
Right. At least the world is thinking about it, even though we are not
very much
able to.
Like all these funding organizations, like your Development Bank, the multilateral agencies, the IMF, and all this is very much catering to the UN Sustainable Goals and its economic sustainability. So even today, the World Bank, the IMF, all the multilateral agencies are very much taking that as the maximum priority.
Right.
Like ADB may be focusing on infrastructure.
Right.
You may think that infrastructure is now directly doing to the economic development. But if they're focusing on infrastructure, then infrastructure is indirectly catering to the economic development.
Right.
So in some manner or the other, they're all actually working towards that.
Very, but sir, that opens another, you know, very important part, and that inequality, and so, means in your opinion, why does it happen?
I mean, if I could answer it,
yeah,
then possibly I would have got the Nobel Prize that Joseph Stiglitz got, and not Joseph Stiglitz. Maybe Om Burish Dasgupta would have been there in the Nobel laureate list.
But in your opinion, I'm just
because his whole work was on inequality, his book was on inequality, he got the Nobel Prize also on inequality. Inequality can happen because it can also happen because of wrong interpretation or wrong implementation of the capitalist notion. And as Joseph Stiglitz himself mentions, that it's a very wrong, it's a bad word to say, a fraudulent interpretation of the capitalism could lead to inequality. Not that socialism or communism is the only panacea to an inequality.
Absolutely.
Even a capitalism, to a proper appropriate flow of the money, rather than creating any kind of, as we saw in the movement of Occupy the Wall Street movement was one such, when there is a creation of a funny money type of a concept, like on the market value, where there is no real cash flowing down, the percolation of that with a little bit of a funny money concept, which comes more with the flamboyance and the capability of money to sell something to the people. So as they mentioned, even Noam Chomsky also mentioned the same thing, that as we really move from core sector to an economy more of selling and convincing,
right,
the inequality possibly will be more coming in.
Right.
Because they feel that more and more we contribute to the core sector, to the manufacturing, to the infrastructure, to commodity market, and we really drive our technology, research, and everything more towards that, the inequality will come down. More we drive people towards the capital world, like all the private equities, the venture capitalists, the non-banking financial sectors, which is more working towards the creation of a concept where the cash does not exist.
Right.
The inequality may bound to come in.
Mm-hmm.
Because now, this is not my view, so please do not hold me responsible for this. These are the views that are coming from them, and this could be also not their exactly views. This could be my wrong interpretation of their views also, because their views are so difficult.
Right.
But so therefore, it's a very difficult thing to explain from where inequality is actually coming in. So the inequality could be a factor of a policy. Inequality may actually be assessed dynamically, and then one can really start assessing the reasons which have controlled, which has fostered the inequality as of now, work on that, make it somewhat equal. It will again, inequality will come in, then again one can work on that, because the human nature,
it's also cyclic.
Yeah, the greed of the human nature cannot be controlled, because I will definitely try to make more out of the overall zero-sum game of the overall world's money. So I will definitely try to make more. So by policy I can be controlled, and then I will again start making it unequal, and then again it can be controlled. So it could be controlled by policy.
Right. We are almost at the end of the program, but before we end, we want to know about your, you know, current engagement in Intuory Consulting. So you tell something about Intuory, what does it do, and what is your, you know, day-to-day activities in Intuory?
Intuory is solely if not primarily, but solely rather, is a strategy consulting firm. So I wanted to create Intuory because I felt after having worked for 24 years in multinational consulting firms, that India is very strongly dominated by the multinational, international consulting firms. Even in the tier one, yes, even in tier two, tier three also, the consulting firms have all their roots outside India. So therefore they control the consulting environment very strongly here. But interestingly, in most of this consulting, even in the international offices of theirs also, it will be the Indians who will be working. Even in some of the organizations of this international firm, the leaders are also Indians. So therefore I wanted to have an Indian consulting firm coming up. We have a lot of Indian IT firms, but a pure play Indian strategy consulting firm where Indian people studying in the Ivy League colleges of the international can come back and work here. Indian economists, Indian political analysts, Indian researchers of the humanities, social science, they can come and do. So that was the objective or intent with which we started Intuory, with three main dimensions: strategy, research, and corporate finance. So it's primarily a strategy firm and a research firm, engaging people who want to do strategy work, who want to do more of the research, working at this point in time more with the private corporates, because we are just 1 year old, so therefore it will be difficult for us to qualify the government criteria and get government jobs, so therefore mainly for the private enterprises. But we do a lot of research work for the policymakers, for the governments also, which we publish through, so therefore our concepts and we work on the policy, but our revenue earning is by serving the Indian corporates on their strategy formulation. Strategy could be in growth, in the cost reduction, board structuring, organizational strategy, international expansion, acquisition, merger, anything, IT, anything.
Viewers, today we talked about inclusive sustainable development. We tried to understand how different countries can play different roles. Maybe UN goal for every country is to maintain everything and observe everything is not possible, but every person has some contribution to play, some role to play to contribute in sustainable development. I thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Mr. Ambarish Dasgupta.
My pleasure.
You have been a very wonderful inclusion to our program. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you.